want to underscore again that we're coming to Chicago peacefully, but whether we're given permits or not, we're coming.
We're going to Chicago to protest the Vietnam War.
And there's no place to be right now but in it.
We watched for a decade while these rebels without a job tell us how to prosecute a war. Well, they're going to spend their 30s in a federal facility, real time.
People say, you know, Abbie, are you concerned about an overreaction from the cops?
Holy shit.
You all right?
It was until I saw that.
Are the people ready to make opening arguments?
At the defense table.
Abbie Hoffman, Jerry Rubin, Dave Dellinger, Rennie Davis, Lee Weiner, John Freund, Tom Hayden, and Bobby Seale.
These defendants had a plan, and the plan was to incite a riot.
I call this portion of the trial with friends like these.
My trial's begun without my lawyer.
The court assumes you are being represented by the Black Panther sitting behind you.
The riots were started by the Chicago Police Department.
Sustained.
Nobody objected.
Jurors 6 and 11, they're with us.
Juror number 6 and juror number 11, you're dismissed from this jury.
Can you tell us why?
Because this is my courtroom.
We've dealt with jury tampering, wiretapping, a defendant that was literally gagged.
Get your hands off me!
You're the first to suggest that I have discriminated against a black man.
Then let the record show that I'm the second.
When we walked in here this morning, they were chanting that the whole world is watching.
If we leave here without saying anything about why we came in the first place, it'll be heartbreaking.
Well, last summer, why did you come to the convention?
To end the war.
We're giving them exactly what they want, a stage and an audience.
Yeah, you really think there's going to be a big audience?
Here I am! All the world's watching!
This is what revolution looks like, real revolution. We may have to hurt somebody's feelings.
Is this prosecution politically motivated?
I'm tired of hearing you.
It would be impossible for me to care any less what you are tired of.
Here I am!
The whole world's watching!
There will be order!
The whole world's watching!
We have to find some courage now.
The whole world's watching!
Now, how much is it worth to you? What's your price?
To call off the revolution?
My life.
Open your eyes, cause a new day is dawning. The new day is dawning.
The whole world is watching.
You've had television interviews before, and
no, it's the first.
This is the first television interview
yeah.
You've had?
Lights are hot.
We were radicals, but we were working for CBS. There was a kind of tension there, you know?
Is the trial staged well enough for you, or do you think it's...
The trial is absolute poetry. It's the most fascinating thing I've ever seen. It's really good. Was it for the law, we'd win easy. But
how do you think the trial will affect, you know, like what's going to happen in the
it's going to get... It'll give a lot of people in the establishment headaches. They'll cry a lot. Well, because they're... Their world is like falling apart, and the world that they suppose that they like learned about in the third grade and they think is existent in this country, it's this trial just like rips a mask off that. It's like that's ridiculous. So you have we have essentially an action the same as we had in Chicago last year. There was in the streets, now it's in the courts, but it's an action that's going to divide the ruling class.
You think the ruling class is beginning to...
Well, I mean, Life magazine called it an act of vengeance, you know, not a trial. Time magazine has already said we're being railroaded. I mean, when you get the mass media like that, dividing up and splitting, you know, along the different issues, and then you, like, sort of move in and you say, look, you know, what we really need is a revolution. We really got to overthrow the country. See, we want money, we want guns, we want dynamite, lollipops, acid, dope, everything.
Welcome once again to The Radical Imagination. I'm your host, Jim Vrettos. I'm a sociologist who's taught at John Jay College of Criminal Justice and Yeshiva University here in New York City. In his recently released film, The Trial of the Chicago Seven, Aaron Sorkin depicts the original 1968 political trial of seven young radicals, formerly the Chicago Eight. They were accused of conspiracy and crossing state lines with intent to incite a riot relating to anti-Vietnam War and countercultural protests during the 1968 Democratic National Convention in Chicago. It portrayed a time in America of deep, deep cultural, racial, and political polarization, not unlike our own. It showed an America of out-of-control police violence, massive street protests by young Americans, a deeply despised, emotionally troubled president, an imperious, vindictive, and out-of-touch judge, a bitter example of how the legal rights of a Black defendant's life didn't matter. Challenge media, a world of paranoid surveillance, all set up against the backdrop of an increasingly failing, hyper-militarized American state, gripped by the urgency of protesters, challenging a dying empire, desperately attempting to cling to power. The film also portrayed one of the most electrifying cultural revolutionaries of the era, who embodied the quintessential spirit and contradictions of the time. It introduced many younger Americans and reintroduced many older ones to one of the seven defendants, Abbie Hoffman, the iconic political and social activist who had been involved in countless protests and demonstrations in the 60s, 70s, and 80s, including the March on the Pentagon, the Columbia University strike, a festival of life, and the Battle of Chicago, the Days of Rage. Abbie was the co-founder of the Yippies Youth International Party and a leading proponent of flower power, using comical and outlandish theatrical tactics to bring about radical change and raise consciousness. Among these activities was organizing anti-war protesters to use their collective psychic energy to levitate and exorcise the Pentagon, nominating a domesticated pig, Pigasus the Immortal, Pigasus J. Pig, for president, and throwing handfuls of money, fake and real, from the gallery of the New York Stock Exchange down at the trading floor while traders scrambled frantically to grab the money as fast as they could. Abbie is played fittingly in the movie by Sacha Baron Cohen of Borat and Ali G. Abbie was quite serious, though, about his radical commitment, remarking in his autobiography, "I grew up thinking democracy is not someplace to hang your hat. It's something you do. The price for my revolutionary activism is my life." We're thrilled to have today on the Radical Imagination one of Abbie's longtime fellow travelers and friend, author of what critics acknowledge is the definitive biography of Abbie, For the Hell of It, The Life and Times of Abbie Hoffman. Jonah Raskin is professor emeritus at Sonoma State University, where he was the chair of the Communications Studies Department from 1988 to 2007. A respected scholar and academic, he's the author of 16 books. And his book, The Mythology of Imperialism, was cited by Columbia University professor Edward Said as one of the generally important handful of books on modern literature published in the last two decades. Jonah's a writer and freelance journalist who participated extensively in the radical counterculture of the 60s and 70s, joining with Abbie, Jerry Rubin, and Paul Krasner to form the Yippies, becoming their minister of education in 1970, helping Abbie go underground in 1974, and traveling with him when he was a fugitive for much of the 1970s. He writes, "It was nearly impossible to know the real Abbie Hoffman. You couldn't be sure when he was acting, when he was real, or when he was acting for real." He suggests that Hoffman saw himself as just a Jewish kid from Worcester, an outsider, exile. Wanderer through life, a very funny and a very sad character, exuding not only the optimism and joy of the 60s, but also its darkness and despair. Abbie was the first American cultural revolutionary in the age of television. His life became a narrative blend of fiction and history, news and entertainment. As Jonah puts it, his biography is a historical interpretation of the times, a contribution to what Tom Hayden described as ongoing struggle today to define the 60s. Abbie helped define that and recaptured the concept of revolution to mean a revolution that Americans could understand and take part in, a revolution of the 60s, by the 60s, and for the 60s. Revolution just for the hell of it. So, Jonah, thank you so very, very much. As you know, I've been wanting to do a show with you for a long time. I wanted to talk about Abbie, and you're the best person in the world here to have a discussion with. And so I'm so grateful to have you on.
Thank you very much. Thank you for that introduction. Thank you for reading there. I'm always happy to talk about Abbie. I think about him probably every day.
Yeah.
Yeah, imprinted in my mind, and I know it's January 2021 on the calendar, but it feels like it's always the 60s. The 60s never ends.
Absolutely, absolutely, and we are, as we're saying before the show, we are taping this on January 6th, yeah. And there's all kinds of protests in Washington. This is the day, of course, that Congress is certifying the election, and Trump is saying he's never going to concede, and there's all kinds of threats of violence and so on and so on. So yeah, it does feel like, even though we're hunkered down in the pandemic, it does feel like the 60s. But for our audience, maybe we can begin by trying to characterize, I know this is a huge, huge question, but what would you like to say about the 60s that made it so profoundly definitive and important?
Depends what day you ask me. I probably would have, you know, different things to say about the 60s,
I understand.
You know, at different times.
How about today?
Yeah, I remember, there are historians who I admire who like to talk about what they call the long 60s.
Mm-hmm.
They say started in 1955 with the civil rights movement and went all the way for the next 20 years to 1975 when the U.S. troops finally got out of Vietnam. So that whole period was the time of the war in Vietnam. I mean, U.S. Military people, as soon as the French lost at the Battle of Dien Bien Phu in 1954, the Americans started going in there.
Yeah, advisors under the guise of being.
Yes, advisors. I mean, and, you know, yeah. The CIA people were there, and I just saw a clip where Eisenhower is talking on the camera, and he just puts right out there, and he says, well, Vietnam, they have tin and they have tungsten. We need those things. We have to be there.
Right.
So, you know, all that stuff about saving the world for democracy, that was PR, but behind there, that was the tin and the tungsten. And I remember reading the Pentagon Papers, where they talk about all the resources in Vietnam that they think they need. Yeah. So I did go to Vietnam once. I was not a combatant there. I went 20 years after the war ended. I was there in 1995. I was mostly in Hanoi. Yes, go ahead, Jim.
No, just what brought you to that trip? What was it?
Curiosity.
Curiosity. Okay.
I felt like I had lived with Vietnam for such a long time, reading about it, talking about it, protesting about it. I mean, I met with representatives of the Viet Cong three times during the war.
Uh-huh.
Once in London, when they served me roast beef and potatoes. I mean, the Vietnamese are serving roast beef. Gee, not very Asian.
Stir fry maybe. Well, no. But,
yeah.
let's back up a minute here. Okay, yes. you're a New York kid, born New York kid.
Yes.
All right, and you had a pretty solid academic, fairly traditional academic career going, correct? And you established yourself, and then what? You began to identify with the movements of the late '50s, early '60s. You were still what in New York, and when did you then go to California, or when did you move, or we were based in New York during that time as well, and what happened?
Well, okay, so I would say that in the late '50s, early '60s, I was moving along two parallel tracks. One of them was academic at Columbia, and the other one was political, which was all over New York City. I was among those people who were protesting nuclear testing and the atomic bomb, and I was also protesting segregation. I used to picket in front of Woolworths in Manhattan with other people, and with a bunch of my classmates, we created an organization in the early 60s called Action, which called for the end of the House Committee on American Activities, the end of investigating people for their political beliefs. I graduated from college in 63. I went on to graduate school in 64 and got an MA. And at that time, I realized that the only way I was going to get another degree is if I got out of the country. Because I would get pulled into the political movements and the political upheaval.
Jonah, it's a great point you're making. So that the spirit of the times, and I experienced that with you as well, was so overpowering. I mean, I had a little bit of talent as a pianist, but as soon as what was going on started to really affect me, that was it. It was I still an academic career going to a certain extent, but now. The 60s was all enveloping. What was going on was you just couldn't resist it. That's what I was trying to get at. What needed?
Yes, I think that's good. I joined the resistance, but I couldn't resist the 60s.
Right.
And none of us could. I mean, we thought we were shaping history, but history was also shaping us. It was both of those things that were going on. So I got married in August of 64, and my wife at the time, Eleanor, and I went to Manchester, England, a working class town, and we were there for the next 3 years, mostly caught up in, you know, British life and British politics and reading about what was happening in the United States. In the New Statesman, Andrew Kopkine was writing about it. And then I was a folk song fanatic in those days, and my wife was a folk singer. So, you know, folk music was a big part of our world. I did not know any other Americans in Manchester, England. I mean, maybe they were there. I'm not sure. So I was doing
You were there from 64 to 67?
Yes.
You were there 3 years. Okay.
Yes.
And this is you felt that you were not going to be able to sit down and do the academic work because there was so much going on in the state, and yet you kept up. From England and Manchester, looking at what was going on and still attempting to do your writing and to a certain extent maintain an academic profile as well.
Yeah, so in 1969, I met a British woman writer by the name of Doris Lessing, who won the Nobel Prize for Literature, I don't know, a while ago. And Doris was telling me, you know, I sit down to write, to concentrate on this book, and I just automatically think about the what's happening in Algeria and what's happening in Vietnam, or all these political upheavals all around the world. So, you know, that she was a different generation. I mean, I was surprised when she said that because she wrote so many books, and I was wondering how could she get distracted. But I mean, it impinged. That's the word I would say. It would impinge. Vietnam just profoundly impinged on our consciousness. Mm-hmm. Yes, living with it, sleeping with it, eating it, sleeping with it. what an outrageous thing. Wow, what a criminal enterprise on the part of the United States. We had no business sending hundreds of thousands of troops there and bombing the place to smithereens. And I was in Manchester, and my mother called me on the phone in the house where I was living and said, "Oh, you got a letter from your draft board saying to show up for your physical."
Yeah, I was going to ask you about that. Did you ever?
Yes. So I did some research and found that, number one, if you were married, number two, if you were living in another country, number three, if you were a student, you could get a deferment. So I wrote a letter to my draft board and I asked for a deferment, and I was granted a deferment. When I came back to the States in like September of 67, I got reclassified by my draft board, and I was actually eligible until I was 35.
You were 1A? You were 1A? You're classified as?
Yes, but then I never got drafted because, as you know, the draft ended and they just sent the Vietnamese in there to get slaughtered.
So when did you meet Abbie? When was the first meeting? And how did that come about?
Well, I saw Abbie at Stony Brook, the State University of New York at Stony Brook, where I was teaching. And Abbie and the Yippies showed up and to do a mock drug raid on the campus because the Suffolk County police had raided a big drug raid, a press conference, and they showed some pipes and rolling papers. That's what they found, you know. It was comic in and of itself. So, but the Abbie and the Yippies decided to do this mock raid. They got some cars, they painted them up to look like police vehicles. They didn't storm the campus. They had their own press conference. So I saw him there. And then I also saw him once on the stage at the Fillmore East, where he kind of dramatized his own transformation, because he had been a traveling salesman in the 60s on the road. You know,
he was from a fairly traditional middle-class Jewish suburban household, correct?
And bar mitzvah, went to synagogue. Right. Yes, right. Exactly.
Bright
guy.
Thought
it was conservative, you know.
Right.
So he did this on stage. He came out in, you know, wearing a suit and tie, which he wore when he out to sell these pharmaceuticals. And then he did this kind of striptease. And then at the end, he's there in like tie-dye t-shirt and jeans and with his hair, you know, and he also undid his hair, which he had tied down, so he had his jufro, as it was called.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So I knew him as a performer. Then in the winter of 1970, my ex-wife, or wife at the time who I mentioned, Eleanor, was with the Weather Underground. And she and they trusted me to be like a courier and a go-between. That was one of the things I did for and with the Weather Underground, was to deliver messages from...
Jonah, just tell our audience again, what this was a sect of the SDS which began to think or advocate some sort of violent revolution, or a cadre of people that would use violence to get the revolution going, much as they perceived Che did in Latin America. And we've had Mark Rudd on the show here too, and he explained the sort of transformation that he went through and the delusions he was under at that time. But anyway, that's another issue.
Yes,
but
that's another, so, yes.
Rudd, yeah.
I saw Rudd, when he was underground once, And he came, and there was a bunch of other fugitive wanted people. And he came up to me and he said, Jonah, I feel so terrible. I feel so racked with guilt about the explosion at the townhouse in March 1970, which took the lives of our three comrades. Nobody felt as guilt-ridden as Mark Rudd.
Maybe his best friend, yeah. And his other best, another great friend of his is still in prison for that. And so,
anyway, back to like the winter of 1970, where I get a message from Eleanor, whose code name was Rita, after, you know, lovely Rita made, and says, meet me on the second floor of Macy's in the bedding department. So I get there and she says, I want you to deliver a letter to this address on East 13th Street. It didn't have any name on the outside of it. And she said, just go there, knock on the door, give the letter to the person who answers, and then walk away. Those were my instructions. Mm-hmm. So I go to the address, I take the elevator up to the last stop, then I walk to the penthouse, I knock on the door, and Abbie Hoffman answers. So then Abbie says, I say, I have a letter here for you. He says, well, come on in. You know, I wasn't supposed to do that. So Abbie opens the letter and reads it out loud, and it's signed by somebody named Molly. And he says, oh, Molly, that's Bernadine Dorn's code name. Mm. So wow. That was the beginning of my friendship with Abbie.
Right.
Where he and I bonded. And so it also tells you, Abbie was really not capable of being quiet and keeping secrets. He was such a public personality.
Exactly. To use the Bernadine Dorn's name to somebody just walked in the door there.
Yes.
I mean, it's a little well, all right. So then you as you say, you bonded, and then you were very, very good friends, and for over 20 years you knew him. And how did you come to write your the biography of him? How did that come about?
Well, after Abbie died, he did commit suicide. I know people have said he didn't commit suicide. He was assassinated by the CIA. There's no evidence of that. So when Abbie died, it was big news. He was on the cover of People magazine. I had a literary agent at the time, Sandy Dykstra, and she called me up and said, we want you to write, you're the perfect person to write the biography of Abbie Hoffman. That's how it happened. I said, no. Yes, I'll do it.
Give our audience an idea of how influential Abbie was during this period. The amount of energy that he expended on the activism and the impact it had on the larger culture is enormous, right?
Yes, definitely. He was in the news. He was on the news. He was the news. He understood how you could get on TV, which is one of the things that the Yippies were famous for. You do guerrilla theater. You stage these dramatic actions, like going to the stock exchange and going up into the visitors gallery and throwing dollar bills down on the floor, and the stockbrokers, run around for them. That was one of the first, even before they called themselves Yippie. That was a Yippie event before Yippie. So Abbie, I would say from that moment on, He was in the news, and the Pentagon came after that, and levitating the Pentagon and having press conferences and being on the Lower East Side. I mean, he was at one of the places in the country where all the action was taking place.
John, I was going to say, how much of this is, in a sense, the New York bubble of the radical New York bubble here, or is it I mean, he struck a chord around the country, too, among young people, obviously. But he made the news. He was a product of the news. And a sort of, obviously, a countercultural figure. But how did he connect with some of the more political organizing, let's say, of a Tom Hayden, and how it was portrayed in the movie?
Well, you use the word bubble. I would say that a certain point, I mean, around 1967 or so, maybe 66, people, why it happened, I think some of it had to do with the art scene and the way that the art world was becoming politicized because of Vietnam. There was this thing called Angry Arts Week. There was Ed Sanders' bookstore, the Peace bookstore. I mean, there was the legacy of the old Bohemians who'd become hippies. So there was a lot of ferment in New York. And people would say, oh man, this is the center of the known universe. I mean, it wasn't long afterwards that John and Yoko moved to New York. And there were people who were part of the Diggers in San Francisco who came to New York. It was the place to be. When I returned to Manhattan in 67, I didn't know that was true. It was just the place to go back to. So Abbie, these events like the Pentagon from October 67, before that, the year before that, the stock exchange. I mean, he was in the street all the time, and he was in the news. So New York is the media, it probably still is, right? The media capital of the world, or of a good part of it. So it was, everybody watched Walter Cronkite. So the New York news spread nationally. It was the place to be.
He also tried to bring together the various factions of the left at that time, whether it was the Panthers, whether it was some of the women's movement, so on. And he's seriously trying to strategize in some concrete way to build and expand the movement as such? Or am I going?
Well, just to finish about the bubble, the New York bubble spread all around the country. So there were communes everywhere. There was SDS chapters. There were yippies all over the place. In 68, 69, there was some people in SDS who said, we have to go into the factories and organize the workers, because the workers are the ones who are going to make the revolution. Abbie said, well, I don't think so. We're cultural revolutionaries. The place to go is Hollywood. We want to organize Hollywood. We want to take over Hollywood. So, mm-hmm. I mean, he did that. He went, his book, Revolution for the Hell of It, came out. I mean, that spread his word and his name as much as anything. It was a bestseller. It was in paperback. He didn't have his real name. He said, buy free.
Buy free. You know? Here it is.
That was his pseudonym. You know, that's him. So, yeah. Yippee, I mean, there was nobody else who said, like, as he did, I'm going to tell jokes, and the jokes that end up get you laughing, and when you laugh, you're going to go out and riot. Other people said, I'm going to get you angry and pissed off, and you're going to go out and trash. Abbie's approach was totally different.
Where did you fall in on this? I mean, you had a sort of Marxian orientation at one point in your life. Your father, right? Your folks had attended meetings of the Communist Party, then dropped out of that. But you had that in your roots as well. So where did you fit in all this?
I was a Marxist. I called myself a Marxist. I got in trouble at Columbia when I was a student for writing what this teacher's called Marxist, essays. Mm-hmm. And Marxists had been kicked out of academia in the 50s, 60s. So I did join SDS. I came back from Manchester, England. My wife and I both joined SDS. We got New Left Notes, the SDS newspaper, in the mailbox. I went to SDS meetings at Columbia. I was arrested in 68, though I was already teaching down at Stony Brook. So I was trying to
straddle a couple of worlds here.
Yes, yeah, straddling is exactly it. I mean, I did want to get tenure. I mean, I've been in school for 7 years. I didn't really want to throw it away. So I was hoping to have tenure, and all my professors said, wait till you have tenure, and then afterwards you can go out and do anything crazy that you want to do.
Right, exactly.
Well, so I got arrested at Columbia, and everybody knew. Then I was protesting against the assassination of Fred Hampton and Mark Clark in Chicago in December 69, and got arrested and got beaten up and tortured by the police. I'm not exaggerating when I say tortured. So, and that was in the New York Times, and it was I was on the front page, my name and picture, and a story about me on the front page of the Village Voice. So all of my efforts to be very discreet, were for naught. Because there I was.
That was the end of the dreams of tenure, too, I guess. But
They voted not to give me tenure.
I would, yeah. You made the front page of the time. No, that was it's a powerful story. But tell me a couple of things about what your impressions are of the movie and the historical accuracy, how the seventh. Bobby Seale as well. The eight defendants were characterized. And maybe touch also on the cultural wars that Abbie and the Yippies and others had, and how it's relating to the counter movement today. Are we still battling those cultural wars today, obviously?
Yeah, all right. So I just wanted to go back just a tad and say that I felt more simpatico with the Yippies than with SDS. I mean, you know, with Abbie and Jerry, definitely, and then later Stu Albert and Judy Gumbo, they were my people more so than the undergraduates in SDS. I thought that Abbie was smarter than them. I mean, he was already a veteran. He went to Berkeley in 1960 and he protested the execution of Carl Chessman at San Quentin. And he protested the House Un-American Activities Committee in 1960 going to San Francisco. So, I mean, by the time Columbia happened in 68, the guy had been doing stuff for almost a decade. So I respected that.
He was truly right. And he was truly operating under Marx's idea of praxis.
Yeah.
He was doing it.
Exactly.
Whereas a lot of the people you were talking about were thinking about it and that funny story about Rudd calling people over to take over one of the buildings and trying to coax one of the SDS members to come, who's sitting under a tree reading Marx or something. You know, and he could come. I said, this is the time. This is the time. You're either going to sit under the tree and keep reading or come on in the building. So I get it.
I was in the car driving with Abbie, and we went to pick up Jerry Rubin, who'd had to go to a hospital. So we got him in the car. And we're driving back to Manhattan from the Bronx. And I said to Jerry, and I said, listen, as you know, I teach at the college and there's a lot of students who are active. And I think that the Yippies should have a student contingent, and they said, that's a great idea. And I said, well, how about if we have like a Yippie, a minister of education? They said, oh, that's a great idea. So I said, well, can I bring it up at the next meeting to have a Yippie minister? They said, no, we don't have to do that. You are the Minister of Education. So If that had been in SDS, you know, there would have been had to been meetings and voting.
Right.
You know, so you just do it. You know, everybody is making their own revolution, and you don't have to be subject to some central committee or chairperson. You trust people to have their, you know, revolutionary instincts. So the movie, all right, so the movie came out. I did see the movie Netflix. I think it was, I had to put in a code word, and I watched it. So when I watched it, I was not watching it for entertainment. I was watching it as a movie reviewer and a cultural critic. So that was the way it was framed for me, or I framed it for myself. So soon after that, I was getting emails from people, old friends and people all over the world, and saying, what do you think of the movie? You know, is it a good movie? It is a bad. So I said to everybody, watch the movie, decide for yourself. I'm not the cultural commissar, you know. So I did, and I did write three things about the movie for three different publications. The last thing I wrote was, go see the movie and make up your own mind. The first two that I wrote were more, you know, dissecting it and taking it apart. I remember the first thing I wrote, I said, well, you know, the movie doesn't, it's not factual. This is not historically accurate. Yes, there was a trial, and yes, there were these defendants, but very little of what people say in the movie and the way they say it and, you know, really happened. It's all been, the guy is monkey with it, you know. There is a lot of inaccuracy. You saw me on the screen here. I knew by the time, you know, what is it, 2000, I saw the movie. I'd met Abbie, you know, at his place in 1970. So what is that, 50 years later? Mm-hmm. So I've got 50 years of experience with this guy, and then I see this movie in which he's supposed to be depicted. I was under-impressed.
I understand. Yeah. There'd be little question that Abbie would be out on the streets today. He'd be down in Washington. He often talked about protesting the day after. What does he mean by that? What else?
I would say one of the geniuses of the yippies and all of the Chicago defendants was to say, well, we're going to try to win this thing in the courtroom with our lawyers and us and our friends on the witness stand. And also we're going to try to beat it by organizing people out in public. So the DAs, the prosecutors, the judge, the Justice Department, they all know that there's a whole lot of people who are following this trial. And if you find these people guilty, there's going to be protests all over the country. So, I mean, while the yippies are on trial, Cherry and Abbie, they're traveling around the country saying, giving speeches and saying, you know, if we're found guilty, we want you to go out in the street and protest. So, and people did that. And there were things in November of 1969, we marched to the Justice Department to protest what was the prosecutions and of the Panthers and also what was going on in Chicago. Yeah.
It was keeping pressure on the culture, on the system. It was not giving in or being bought out. I think that's an important point to make here. We still have several minutes to go, but there's so much to talk about. Tell me a little about, you point out that he saw himself as just a Jewish kid from Worcester. What about his Jewishness there? He was secular, he said he was bar mitzvah, but what was that part of him that What would you make of that feeling that he had, and how did it manifest itself, do you think?
Worcester was a good place to grow up and come of age because it was a microcosm of the U.S. It had police, it had politicians, it had businesses, it had, you know, different classes. So Abby got involved in political activity in Worcester, and he saw the way things operated on a smaller scale. The guy couldn't lose his Jewishness. I mean, he spoke Yiddish. He said there's a certain Jewish, ambiguity. You know, you say one thing and you mean it means two things at the same time, this sort of irony, or there's a certain shrug of the shoulders. He had this sort of Yiddish body language.
Yeah.
So, you know, when the trial happened, and this was perfect to have this old Jewish judge there. So Abby was talking Yiddish to the judge, and translating one of the expressions, you're doing the dirty work for the goyim. You know, you should be ashamed of yourself. And right. Then saying it's like a neon oven, you know, in this place, the kind of, you know, echoing like, you know, fascism. At the time, Abby's blend of hardline politics and humor, you know, he would say that Ronald Reagan was the fascist gun in the West, you know, not the fastest gun. You know, again, he was laughing, you know, it was hard to be around the weather people, and SDS people, they're not cracking wise.
Yeah.
We'd rather be with somebody who's telling jokes and laughing. And,
of course. And,
you know, he wants to go get an egg cream at Jem's Spa. He wants to go to the Jewish delicatessen. He's watched Sid Caesar and Imogene Coca and Carl Reiner. You know, he knows all those what they call borscht belt tumblers, all the Jewish comedians who are entertaining people. So he read Lenny Bruce. He modeled himself after Lenny Bruce. I mean, he also knew, as a lot, you know, other people did, you know, the power of the obscenity. I don't know if I can.
And he dedicated one of his books to Lenny as well. And we've had Monty Marmo on the show, who's been a remarkable, terrific, as a one-man show where he does portray Lenny Bruce. Jonah, we have a couple of minutes. I am really, I so enjoyed this. I am also super frustrated that we only have a couple more minutes, because this could go on for hours. Tell us briefly, he did get discouraged, right? At the end, what was that about? And you say it's suicide.
Abby was the 80s was not, didn't feel like his time and place. I mean, Reagan was there.
Right.
The 60s ended, early 70s. He thought that the empire was just going to really totally go away. He didn't expect the empire to strike back. So when it happened, he was an unhappy fellow, and he would go around to college campuses and talk, and the generation that he was meeting were not, they loved to see him, they laughed at his jokes, but they weren't protesting. Many of them were not protesting. So he felt, he wanted to be among his people. He couldn't.
Would he have a better reception today, do you think? The younger people.
I mean, people have told me that they watched the movie, the Chicago Sun movie, and then they wanted to read about Abbie Hoffman. So
absolutely. We've had Lisa Fithian as well, and one of the, followers also of Abbie. Listen, Jonah, would you promise me to come back and we can do some more on this?
Oh, absolutely, absolutely, you, yeah.
Really, I'm gonna
hope to. I'd love to. This has been fun. It's been enjoyed great. Listening to you talk.
No, listen, I'm. This is just a very small part of what I wanted to talk about with you. So there's a lot more to do. And so let me just thank you again so very, very much. Sure. I'm so sorry we've run out of time. I'll be in touch with you. We'll set up another show. And I just want to thank all of you watching us today on The Radical Imagination. Read Jonah Raskin's book, a hell of it, The Life and Times of Abbie Hoffman. That's an assignment. It's not a required being. We're going to have Jonah back in 2-3 months, hopefully. And we will discuss the work more. And,
all right. Thank you very much. And
thank you very much. In the meantime, if you see Steal This Book, Abbie Hoffman, Steal This Book, you see it in the bookstore, well, you do what you think you need to do. But Abbie would tell you, steal it. All right. Thank you very much. All the best. We'll see you next week. Thank you, Jonah, so much.
Right.
Say goodbye for the Radical Imagination. All the best. Thank you.
You have to realize that there's a problem with the whole educational system, and not all the 60 million functional literates identified by Jonathan Kozel are in the streets. Lots of them are in the universities. And it's partly, I mean, you've got to put a lot of the blame on TV. At the same time you're blaming it, you've got to learn how to use it. See, TV, unlike the other media, movies, reality, books, etc., TV gets into your fantasy world. That's why the images are shot, blurred, and at the same time very specific, and they keep fading, and they're in short bits and zoom in and out. That's what fantasy's about. They're not dreams, and they're not reality. So if you want to enter the fantasy world of America, which you have to, because people watch 7 hours of television a day, and that's how they get their information, you have to learn how to use it. It isn't enough just to whack it as a medium. You also have to learn